Yeah, thank you so much, choir. That was a good worship time. Let's celebrate them. Let's appreciate God for the lives of the worship team. Oh, yes. I know our time is fast spent today, but we should be done by 12:15. Okay. As our habit is, let's rise up together for the reading of the first word of the day. And that is from the book of Numbers, chapter 22. Shall I use Numbers or shall I use? Yeah, let me use Numbers. Okay, no, sorry, Mark 11. Let's use Mark 11. Mark chapter 11, verse 23. Are we all together? Mark 11, verse 23. Are we all there? Let's read together. One, two, go. It says, for assuredly, I say unto you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed, be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have what? Now I want you to pay very close attention to the two words in that scripture, whoever and whatever. Now who is whoever? Anybody? Father, thank you for your word this morning. We bless your holy name because you're going to speak through me. Let nothing that is not of you proceed from this mouth in the name of Jesus. I ask you, think through me. You open the eyes of the understanding of your people. You give them the word for the season. The word that will create a turnaround. That it will thank you. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. You can please be seated. This morning, by God's grace, I'll be teaching on what is titled the power of our words, or what I call the power of our confession. You can call it the power of your confession, or you can call it the power of our words. Isaiah chapter 42, verse 22. Let's go to Isaiah 42, verse 22. Isaiah chapter 42, verse 22. You all remember that what do we call this year? What's this year, church? The year of what? Restoration. Isaiah 42, verse 22. Isaiah chapter 42, verse 22. In that scripture, the Bible says that, but these are people who are robbed and plundered. All of them are snared in holes, and they are hidden in prison houses. They are for prey, and no one delivers. For plunder, and no one says what? Restore. So you can see that anytime that God wants to do something in the lives of his people, he expects them also to begin to say it. So he was saying here that Israel had been plundered. He was saying that people have stolen things from them. But God could not do anything because nobody was saying restore. Are you getting it? Are you getting it? It is not just enough for you to say, well, God said it. I don't have to do anything to it. It is your job to do the confession. So that Mark chapter 11, verse 23 that we read, Jesus was saying to the disciples, whoever says to this mountain, be moved. Whoever. He didn't say whoever prays. He didn't say whoever begs. He said what? Whoever what? Says to it. Whoever says to it. You see, our words create our world. If there is something you as a believer must be careful of, even if there is something that anybody on earth must be careful of, it is the types of words you say and how you say them. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 3 tells us that by faith we understand that the worlds were made by what? By the word of God. So that things that be were made out of the things that were not seen. The power of words. God could not have created the heavens and the earth without the word. He couldn't. He couldn't. In fact, the state of the heaven and earth would have still have remained what? Chaotic and full of what? Darkness without God saying, let there be light. In Psalm 120 verse 2, David himself, when David was going to pray, David said, God, deliver me from the arrow of the tongues. Isaiah said in Isaiah 54 verse 17, every tongue that rises against you in judgment shall what? Shall be condemned. So this is telling you that the tongue is powerful. It is powerful. Revelation 12:11. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by what? The words. Proverbs 18:21. Death and life are where? Sorry, where? Did he say in the hand of God? Where is it? In the power of the tongue. So you and I can see that our tongues are powerful. In Numbers chapter 22, we may not be able to read that whole scripture today, but I will try to point some things to you there. Numbers 22 from verse 1. The Bible tells us of a time when Israel, when they were still going through the wilderness, and they are now starting to look for places where they are going to pass through to get to the land of Canaan. On this certain day, there was this king of the Moabites. In verse 2, that king, now Balak the son of Zippor, saw all that Israel had done to the Amorites. And Moab was exceedingly afraid of the people because they were many, and Moab was sick. So Moab said to the elders of Midian, "Now this company will come up and lick everything around us." Now let's read, we jump to verse 5. Then he sent messengers to Balaam the son of Beor at Pethor, which is near the river in the land of the sons of his people, to call him, saying, "Look, a people has come from Egypt. See, they cover the face of the earth, and they are settling next to me." Verse 6, that's it, verse 6 together, I want to go. He says what? "Therefore, what should you do? Please come and do what? Curse these people for me." He knew that, look, he decided to go into war against them. He could not win it. Do you know what he did? He called people that have power to use words. Words are powerful. Words are what? They are powerful. You might be saying, "Well, Pastor, I don't speak negative things. What happens if I don't say nothing?" Let me tell you how powerful words are. Look, if you don't say nothing, you will receive nothing. That's number one. And also, those who have power to use tongues, their words will rule your life. Let me explain this to you very well so you understand it. It is not right for somebody to say, "You are going to fail," and you're keeping quiet and you're smiling. Because you are not countering it at that moment. So what is happening is you are agreeing to it. "I don't worry, that child is going to fall." And you keep saying it. You fall. So when you don't use your words rightly, and somebody is saying something negatively against you, you say, "Oh, no, Pastor, I must keep quiet. You know, we just have to respect." No. Even before doctors, "You have this. I'm sorry, I don't have it. It is not my own." Are you getting this? The power of the words. The power of the words. The law of confession. When you talk about the word confession, we are not just talking about what forgiveness of sin or asking that somebody forgives you. It is a declaration or profession about circumstances or things. It is what we say consciously or unconsciously that creates the world we live in. I give you an example. If you are where you are today, it's a function of what you have said at some point in time. So if you want to change what you are saying, you should change what you are saying. Several times, I get into my house, I sit down every day. At times, for 10 minutes, 35 minutes, 1 hour, I keep saying certain things. "I'm rich by God. I'm not poor. I'm wealthy. The hand of God is upon me." I keep saying it. But you see, because your friends came to you and they say, "Everybody is broke." You say, "We're all broke." They say, "We are struggling. We are managing." I'm not managing. I'm not a manager. I'm not. I am not what? A manager. You think it's cool? It is not cool. The book of Ecclesiastes said what? "Do not say before an angel that it is an error." Because what happens? The angels publish the words that we speak. They do. They just publish the words that we speak. Now, a few things for you to note about confessions. Number one. Okay, I've given you number one already. That anytime God wants to do something, he expects you to declare it. Number two. Man's authority, dominion, victory, or failure is determined by what he sees. When David was going to kill Goliath, you all remember that story very well. Of course, David took stones. But let me first ask you a question. What was the first thing that Goliath used against the children of Israel? Words. He kept threatening them. He kept speaking the words. For some of you people that came from the country where some people came from, I'm from Zion. You all know some people in that country. You know, you have all these people that are, what's it called? That are bus conductors. You can see a bus conductor that is this short. Can be talking to a giant that is this high. and you tell that person, look, Emmy, I will kill you. Get out. You understand? And you, I mean, you'll be looking at this conductor, like, this small you. Because he's trying to use the words to weaken you or to intimidate you. Are you getting it? The Bible says to us that what? But when David got there, let's look at that scripture, 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 17. Church, are you alive this morning? 1 Samuel 17. Look at verse 23. Verse 23 tells us about what Goliath did. Verse 23 says here, then as he talked with them, there was the champion, the Philistine of the Gath, Goliath by name, coming up from the armies of the Philistines. And what did he do? And he spoke according to the same words. If you want to destroy somebody, what do you do? You destroy their own self-esteem. Isn't it so? You talk to them, you talk them down. Isn't it so? That was what Goliath was using. Now let's go further in that same chapter 17. Yeah, that same chapter 17. Now look at what David did. Look at verse 45. Then David said to the Philistine, you see, don't look at your mountain. Speak to it. So David said to the Philistine, if you need courage, use right words. Look at what he said. He said, you come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin. Look at the words. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, Jehovah Sabaoth, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Verse 46. Now David started prophesying. This day, when? Today. The Lord will do what? Will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Then all this assembly shall know that the Lord does not save with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into your hands. Verse 48. So it was when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David. What did David do? That is what David did. What? David ran towards him. Why? The word. He ran towards him. It's foolish. He didn't even mind the size. He ran towards him. Your words determines your victory. You see, what happens is that many times, the reason why many people don't receive what they have believed God for is because what they are saying after praying negates what they have believed God for. I give you an example. Just pray for a sick person. Declare you healed in the name of Jesus. Then they call you. Somebody calls you and say, what is wrong with you? And the person now says, what? I am sick. Then why did we pray? We just canceled it. Are you getting it? We just canceled it. Remember, already says to us, let the weak say that I am strong. The book of Isaiah already tells us that what? That there shall none be ill in Zion. You can't call yourself sick. That was why when God was going to walk with Abraham, his name before was Abraham. Then in Genesis chapter 17, the Lord appeared unto him. And when God said, talk to you about this the covenant. God, let's look at it. Genesis chapter 17. Then, verse 5 says, no longer shall your name be called Abraham, but your name shall be called Abraham. Why? Why? For I have made you what? But did Abraham have Isaac at that time? Did he? No. Are you getting it? Because you don't see something, does not mean it does not exist. Even scientists have been able to prove to us what? That there are different waves in the atmosphere that we cannot see. There are microorganisms in the atmosphere that you cannot see. But you cannot say because you can't see them, they don't exist. God said, that is what I have made you. Maybe you are saying, maybe because you're looking at your bank account in the natural, and you're looking like, it is not where it's supposed to be. You can't say I'm broke. I don't ever say that I'm broke. I can recollect this incident very well. 10 years ago. Ontario. 10 years ago. My mentor called me and he told me he wanted He was organizing a training. To cut a long story short, and he told me how much the training was. And I left a message for him. And I said, sir, you know what? I'm very, very financially buoyant now. I'm very financially capable. But by God's grace, sir, I wouldn't be able to take this course because of that reason. He knew what I meant. You can't say, I don't have the money. Are you getting what I'm saying? But then where will you have it? Are you getting it? So the man called me. He understood. Don't say, look, it is better to get people up to your level than for you to descend to where they are. That is what is happening to many of you. You always want to become. You always want to say, every one of us, we are the same. You want to identify with them. But which one pays you more? For you to bring them up, for you to go down to where they were? Are you getting what I'm saying? I'll give you another example. I've given you this one before. We are at my former office, where I was consulting at that time. There was this guy who was always sick. He was always having this problem with his throat. So we got on the elevator together. My wife remembers this story very well. We got on the elevator together, and I said, what's going on with you? He said, well, I need to go home, that he's taking some time off because his throat has started again. I said, I used to have it too. It used to happen to me. This is the story, very well. And I started telling him all the things, all the symptoms, and everything. So he now says, so what do you do? I said, I told him, okay, these are different things. I prayed. I also prayed that, God healed me. I've been free from it. By the time I got home, my wife remember this day. But I called, I said, my throat. It was like swollen here and there. And I called my wife. And I started saying, my God, I was healed of this thing. 1997. It shouldn't be happening now. And the Lord said to me, do you remember what you said? You didn't give the guy the word. You identified with the situation. And I'm like, oh, that is it. I repented right away. And I prayed and I got over it. Hey, get to this. Oh, it is flu season. All the children, they fall sick. Even my own. Do you have to fall sick? Are you getting it? Are you getting it? I'm not saying you shouldn't see a doctor. I mean, I love doctors. God bless doctors. God bless physicians. But what? You don't say it's like, it's also, we are all the same. We are not all the same. Just like my wife would say, there is a difference between a pecan and a kid. Is it so? That's the difference. What's the difference? Okay. Don't worry. You want to know the difference? Don't worry. There's a very big difference. That is what? All beds are not the same. Let me just give you a line on pool. Let's just be there. All beds are not the same. There's some bed that when some people roll on it, everybody shakes. You understand what I mean? There's some bed that even if you jump, the person on the other side doesn't do it. Are you understanding it? They're all beds, but they are not all what? The same. So because all of us are here, we're not all the same. Are you getting it? Are you getting it? You are, Jesus says, you are from above. He that is from above is what? Above. So you cannot say because all of us have two eyes. The person you are talking to has two nostrils, a pair of nostrils, mouth, and legs. Yes, look alike, but we are not the same. So don't let them talk you down. Joshua, Caleb, and the rest of the spies, they went to go into the land of Canaan. You all remember the story in the book of Numbers, chapter 13. The Bible says, when they got there, they saw the grapes. They saw the apples. They saw the pineapples. Why? They said it's lovely. And then when they got to Moses, let's go there. The book of Numbers. Let's quickly look at it. I believe it's Numbers chapter 13. Yes, Numbers chapter 13. So they saw all those things. Now they were going to give Moses the report. Now, so they said in chapter 20, nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong, okay? The cities are fortified and very large, okay? Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. I'm looking from verse 28. Verse 29. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south. The Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites dwell in the mountains. And the Canaanites dwell by the sea and along the banks of the Jordan. Verse 30. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are what? Well able to overcome it. But the men who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people. Why? For they are stronger than we. Verse 32. And they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land, which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants. And all the people whom we saw in it are men of great stature. 33. Then we saw the giants. The descendants of Anak came from the giants. And we were like grasshoppers in our own sight. Self-esteem. The enemies did not say they looked like grasshoppers. You see, how I wish you understand the perspectives through which the enemy sees you. Let me tell you, so you understand it very well. Many people don't know the way the devil sees them. Because many times the devil is intimidated by you. You remember the story in the book of Exodus chapter 1, where Pharaoh started attacking the children of Israel, and they thought that Pharaoh was oppressing them. They didn't know what was behind Pharaoh's oppression. Pharaoh said, they have increased, and what? They are going to destroy me. So Pharaoh started attacking them. That's what the devil does to you. So you think you're a victim. Oh, pastor, the devil was attacking me. No, it's because the devil saw what you can be, and you haven't seen it. You see, you cannot look down on yourself and expect people to look up to you. It's not possible. It's not possible. It's not possible. 2003, before I came to, I've told all of you this story before. From 2001, I've been wanting to come to Canada to get a fat bank account statements there. I wouldn't get the study permit. What was going on? This particular time, so I went back to God. I'm like, God, what's going on? Anyway, I decided to give it a break. And I said to myself, I don't care where it is. You know what? Wherever I am, I will flourish there. Wherever I am, I will do well there. The long and short of the story was what? I got admission into the University of New Brunswick. And then I sent, what is it called? It was time for me to go and appear at the embassy. Guess what was in the bank account? 50,000 Naira, or about $500 in those days. My tuition fee as an international student was about $9,000. You all understand? For those of you that came as international students, you know how this works. Isn't that correct? And I said, okay, you know what? God is, and God gave me a word. So God asked me, as you start writing down what I would do in Canada, I wrote 21 points down. I said, this land is privileged to have me. I said, in this land, I will buy houses. I will improve this land. I will raise men. I started writing different things I would do. I will give scholarships out. I wrote all of them down. And then I packaged all my application. Now, to get to the embassy, you know, you drop it off, they give you an interview day. On the day of the interview, you bring some other documents. You all remember that? That's what was being done then. So I took it there, and I got there. So when I got there into the interview room, you know, we had that glass barrier. The lady sat on the other side. And then the first thing she did was, from my documents, supposing documents that I gave, she returned them. I said, that's finished today. You know, I said, that's finished today. She returned my documents. I did not know. But she had only one document. Guess what document was? That document that contained the 21 things, my visions and my goals for this land. That was what she held on to. At 3 o'clock, they called. Congratulations, you need to go for your medicals. Do you understand me? It is not money that is stopping, but how do you see yourself? I ended up getting the same land with $75. I will tell you all this story. Your problem is not a money problem. How do you see yourself? It's not a money problem. It's not a money problem. It is not. It's what you say. You keep saying it. Regardless of what you see. You see, don't ever let what you say be determined by what you see. That's all. People are losing their jobs. So I have to prepare because I may. I have to prepare because you've given the enemy a chance. It'll just come in right away. How many of you has that thing happened to you before? You say because, and then the thing happened. And some of you say, you know, I think I have a prophetic mouth. Yes, you do. But you just use it wrongly. Speak the right words. Speak the right words. Speak the right words. Speak the right words. Okay, let me quickly give you 4 points about how we come about what we say, and I will round it up today. And then next week, I will continue and talk to you about the cycle of confession and what are we to say. Okay, let's go like this. How do we come about what we say? Romans chapter 12, verse 1. and then Psalm 1 from verse 1. Romans chapter 12, let's look at it. Romans 12, verse 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you do what? You present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Verse 2. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. The first thing, let's look at Psalm 1. So we can lay a proper foundation for this. Psalm 1 from verse 1. Psalm 1. We all know the scripture very well, but let's look at it. It says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. Who do you hang out with? Let me tell you this, church. It is good to walk with people that are like you. But it is better to walk with people that are better than you. You should walk with who? People who are what? Better than you. We are all the same. I don't want people with people that say we are all the same. No. If you are seeing me and somebody being the same, that's a problem. You understand what I mean? Walk with people who are what? Better than you. Look at people you can learn from. You understand what I mean? You want to go into politics, you want to go into certain fields, you want to go into business, look for people that are better than you. See? Don't move with people that are the ants level. Ants, all of them are just running after one cube of sugar. Are you understanding it? Below is crowded. Go to the top. But the first thing, the circle of influence, the people that are around you. If you need to change your friends, change them. It's not because you hate them. But look, for every level of promotion you get to in life, and for every level you want to get to in life, your relationship must change, whether you like it or not. I'll give you an example. The outgoing president of America, President Barack Obama. You might have gone to secondary school with Barack Obama. You understand what I mean? In fact, both of you might have sat down and said, that's my best friend. You know, he's not the president. Levels have changed. It's not that he hates you, but what is just happening is both because of his office. He cannot be taking out your idea. I mean, the idea that you are using even to manage a relationship of two, you want him to use it to manage a relationship, to manage the whole nation of over 400 million. Are you understanding it? Your association. That's where we learn. Okay, you've sent your children out. For those of you that have children, you've sent them out. You sent them to go on a play date. Or maybe you went to go and spend a night with some people. And they came back the following day. And the children started using some strange words. And you're like, where did you learn this from? Are you getting it? A child that doesn't used to use curse words begins to use such curse words. What has happened? The influence. Subconsciously, you pick up habits from the people you hang out with. Number two. How do we come about our confessions? It's by what we see. By what we see. But people see different things. They look at, you know, what type of programs do you watch? The site, a parent was talking to me some time ago. This was not even here. This was, I think probably over 10 years ago. Well, talking to me about her child. She said to me, the child came to him. About parents, listen to this story. Child was about 10 years old, maybe 8 or 10. The girl said, Mom, there is something troubling me. I now said, but what is it? The child said, look, what happens was I was with Dad. You know, Dad was watching news. And then all of a sudden there was a commercial. And in the commercial, they showed a woman who was seductive. And to cut the long story short, they showed an amorous section on the TV. And the father couldn't say, switch it off. The boy said, look, Mom, but this image has been disturbing my heart since. Are you getting it? Pay attention to what your children are seeing. What you see. The image registered on his mind. She said she'd been noticing the boy. The boy that she would go and pick from school. I will be very lively to talk about school. He will keep quiet. Is everything okay? The boy will keep quiet. I said, no, it's the digital age. I know, but also watch what they watch. Are you understanding me? Pay attention to it. What we see. What we see. I mean, sociologists have made us understand that even people who have seen their parents abused have a tendency of being abused or abusing or being abusive relationships. Because they've seen it. It's registered permanently in their minds. What you see. Number three. What you read. Joshua chapter 1. You see, the Bible is not meant to be read silently. I'll show it to you. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Let's look at that one before we go to Joshua chapter 1. The Bible is not meant to be read silently. I know what I'm saying. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 6. Verse 6. Deuteronomy 6:6. It says here, and these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. That's number one. It shall be in your heart, right? The word of God, okay? And what will happen is what? You shall what? Teach them diligently to your children. And what shall you do? You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. Do you get it? It's not meant to be read silent. You speak it, you speak it. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. The greater one is on the inside of me. The Bible says the path of the just as a shining light, it shines brighter and brighter in the dawn of the day. I decree in the name of Jesus as I go out this day, just in alignment with the word of God, my path shines brighter and brighter. The Bible says my going out is blessed and my coming in is blessed. I therefore decree as I go out today, my going out is blessed, my coming in is blessed. Look, every week, every Sunday, I'll be sending this one to you guys that are on the WhatsApp group now. Every Sunday, do you know what I do? When it comes to the evening, after I've relaxed from all the activities of the weekend, I look at what I need to do in the week. These are the meetings that I have. Okay, no problem. And I'll sit down, I meditate. God, what is the word for the week? When I get the word, I now put those things there in front of me, and I begin to speak to them. You know, that is why, you know, you go to some meetings, some people begin to oppose you for no reason. It's because you didn't prepare. I'm not saying you didn't read, but you didn't prepare with the realm where you need to prepare. Because when you prepare in the realm where you need to prepare, when you enter the place, they just start smiling. Are you getting it? Are you getting it? You prepare yourself. I decree nobody will oppose me in this place today. The Bible says, every tongue that rises against me in judgment shall be condemned. He says that no weapon that is against me shall be. You keep speaking it. You keep speaking it. You keep speaking it. What you read is the word. The more you read the word, the better you become in it. And you don't say, Pastor, I read it yesterday. Did you eat yesterday? How many of you ate yesterday? Are you going to eat today? Why? Huh? That's the same thing with the word of God. You read it every time, every day, every time. That is why, I'm not sure, some of you, there were some cards we were using some time ago, small cards like this. Brother, do you remember? Those small cards, pocket cards, they contain scriptures. Do you know why they were there? Because, so that when you have your break at your lunch time, you take one of it out. He says, for I wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers. Okay, this one is about warfare. You read it. You remember. You are reminding yourself. You are speaking to your spirit. Finally today, how do we come about what we see? It's from what you hear. Information. What you hear. For some people, there is no challenge anywhere. It's just because of the people they listen to. For those of you that were here during the time when we had to take charge, somebody asked a question and said that, wow, how come that it is difficult to enter to succeed in certain fields? That, for example, I've seen people that are doctors that are driving cabs and this and that. And somebody told me, it's difficult. You can't be a doctor in this country. You have to do so many things. I decided to go with this cab, and I've been driving this cab for 25 years. So because you came to Canada, you see the doctor that is driving a cab, and you look at yourself, I only have a diploma. If a doctor is driving a cab, let me just enter the factory. Are you understanding this? What you had? I remember this story very well. One of my friends told me this one. He's also a doctor. This one is Ontario. He said to me that where he was before, I'm not saying that it's not good to start small. But even you don't have to really start small. You understand what I mean? It depends on what your perspective of small is. You understand what I mean? But we can start anywhere. Start small, that's okay. You understand what I mean? But let's do that. So he said he was working at this factory. I'm running up now. And one of his colleagues now told him that, you know what, my bro, you know, you really need to focus on this job. I mean, what you should target now is how to get a license to drive the forklift. That one pays you better, $1 more. You know, that can go a long way. And he looked at himself, I have a medical degree. I'm driving. This guy is encouraging me. And then, that advice is good. But I can see there are some people also on this side. That is where I belong. See, so you can't keep, you see, those types of friends, you just say, you know what, bro, I love you. You understand what I mean? But I can see that, you know, if you used to talk to them for 1 hour before, please reduce it to like 5 minutes. You understand what I mean? Like, look, there are friends you can spend 5 minutes with. You understand what I mean? There are friends that you must not spend 1 hour with. Then there are friends that you must spend 5 minutes, that you need to spend more hours with and not less hours. So you need to discern those friends. No, we need to be going to the same places together. You understand what I mean? It's not that you are going to this place and I am going to this place and you are saying we should go together. What do you mean? Are you understanding it? What you hear, who talks to you, what you see, what you read, your circle of influence. Have you been blessed today? Are you ready to turn your life around in 2017? I want you to rise up this morning as we round up the service. God has been so good. The power of our confession. You can have what you say. That is what the Bible says. You can have what you say. That is what the Bible says. You can have what you say. Just appreciate God for this morning. I want you to just appreciate Him and just say, Father, we thank You.